All right, Shadle. Here we are again. Our last lecture. Very exciting, very exciting. This is period seven. Period seven. Remember, the AP exam, it's one DBQ. It will be somewhere between time periods three and seven, which is 1754 to 1945. So period seven. So in the old, you know, the nine periods, the old AP exam, the original AP exam, this is the largest time period. This makes up about 17% of the AP exam. And so there's a high probability that the DBQ will come from this time period, if I had to guess. Now, every year I guess what I think the DBQ will be, and every year I have been wrong. So take that into consideration. But my guess is that we'll see something from the late 1800s, maybe the Gilded Age, robber barons, industrialism, or populism, the progressive era, something like that. That's my guess, but I'm probably wrong, so don't get mad at me. But this period ends with the end of World War II, so 1945 ends this period. 1890 is there's really not a single event that happens that year. That's usually 1890 is the year that we use for the beginning of the Progressive Era. So 1890 to 1920 is sometimes referred to as the Progressive Era. Sometimes 1901 to 1920 is the Progressive Era because that's the election of Teddy Roosevelt. But really, progressivism starts at the state level and then reaches the federal level with Teddy Roosevelt. So, but if we briefly talk about the three key concepts, 7.1, 7.2, and 7.3, we can kind of get a sense here of what we're going to be talking about. 7.1 is really talking about efforts to reform society and the economic system. And so really three examples of this will be the populace, who we talked about last period, but are still kind of around at the beginning of this period, the progressives, and then Franklin Roosevelt and the New Deal all tried to reform society and the economic system. So we'll talk about those. 7.2, innovations in communications technology, mass culture. This is really the 1920s, the kind of cultural change in the 1920s, but also migration patterns, things like African Americans moving out of the South, the Great Migration, which is largely during World War I. And then 7.3 is a big one, participation in a series of global conflicts. So we will have three wars in this time period: Spanish-American War, 1898, World War I, 1914 to 1918. We don't join until 1917, however. And then World War II, 1939 to 1945. We don't join until 1941. So let's start off, and I'm going to go quickly through this. This is a huge time period. I could spend hours talking about this. I'm going to go really fast. This is just a review. You can do more research on this stuff on your own. So real quick, let's start with Spanish-American War. This is kind of the era of imperialism. Imperialism is really when you try to control a country. You can do that economically, politically, socially, by spreading your religion. You can do all three. And we were kind of late to the game. Europe had been doing this. And so we're joining now in the 1890s, really for two reasons: for access to new markets, so we could sell them our goods, but also access to raw materials that we could turn into goods. So in this era of imperialism, we will get Hawaii, we will get Puerto Rico, Guam, we will get the Philippines. So the Spanish-American War is really fought against the Spanish, obviously, over Cuba. Cuba, 90 miles away from Florida, was a Spanish colony. The Spanish don't treat the Cubans very well. That's well known. But we have been interested in Cuba, you know, for a long time. We wanted it to become a state. It never did because it would have been a slave state. And, you know, that was prior to the Civil War. And that was a big hoopla over that. So we actually send a ship to Havana Harbor. It's called the battleship Maine, and it's sitting there ready to evacuate any Americans if we need to, if stuff gets out of hand and the ship blows up. We blame the Spanish. We thought it was an underwater mine. Later on, we found that it was a malfunction in the engine bay. But this first slide here, you can see this quote from William Randolph Hearst, who was a newspaper owner. And, you know, he was in kind of a race to sell newspapers, a competition against Joseph Pulitzer in New York. And this is known as yellow journalism. Basically, kind of these exaggerated stories, and this played a big role in leading us to war. So yellow journalism and also business interests. War is usually good for business, for, you know, selling stuff, making money. And so they, the newspaper publishers and business people encouraged McKinley to go to war with Spain. And this quote here, Hearst sent someone to Cuba to, you know, take pictures and to find out what's going on. And the photographer said, "Everything is quiet. There's no trouble. There will be no war. I wish to return." Hearst sent back a note. "Please remain. You furnish the pictures. I will furnish the war." So this war is like 114 days. More people died of disease than actual, you know, gunshots. Teddy Roosevelt fought in the war. Blah, blah, blah. Moving on because we need to move quickly. And there's a lot of, you know, there's a debate here. Should we get involved in imperialism? And there's issues dealing with race and racial superiority. Sorry, I can't even talk. You see Uncle Sam here. I showed this picture in class. You know, after the war, we annexed Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippines. We never annexed Cuba because we weren't allowed to because of the Teller Amendment. But we said nothing about Puerto Rico, Guam, and the Philippines. We also got Hawaii the same year. It's not connected with the Spanish-American War. Don't get that confused. You see McKinley here washing the Filipino boy. And so that was, we hadn't even really thought about the Philippines, which is closer to China. And it was also a Spanish colony. But, you know, this would lead to new access to China and to East Asia. So we annexed the Philippines. They didn't want to be annexed. That led to the Filipino-American War. But we held on to the Philippines until the 1940s. You see a picture here of Queen Liliuokalani. She's going to be the Queen of Hawaii. And there was a lot of business interests. There was a lot of white people that moved to Hawaii, people like Sanford B. Dole, the fruit guy. And they believed that they could make more money if they were annexed by the United States, if Hawaii became a territory or a state. And so they overthrew the Queen, and Hawaii was annexed in 1898. So I wanted to move on, briefly talk about Teddy Roosevelt's foreign policy. It's known as, so he becomes president in 1901. McKinley dies. Teddy Roosevelt was vice president. He becomes president. Youngest president we've ever had. 41, 42, something like that. So his foreign policy is known as big stick diplomacy. Basically, speak softly and carry a big stick. That was kind of the old African proverb that his diplomacy was based on. And basically, we're not going to yell at other countries or do all this stuff, but we're going to have this big stick, and that will be our navy, what he referred to as a great white fleet. And you can see this kind of picture here of Roosevelt. But something that he did, we got the Panama Canal during his, it was finished in 1914. I think they started working on it in 1904. Largest construction project of its time. So now you don't have to sail all the way around South America. You can cut right through the right through Panama. So let's talk about the Progressive Era. Again, moving quickly. Progressive Era, 1890 to 1920. So the Progressive Era, really a good way to think of it is they're trying to fix all the problems of the previous era, of the Gilded Age, of industrialism. So there's a lot of good things that we get from industrialization. Really, just, you know, worldwide, industrialization really drastically improved the standard of living for everyone. around the world. And so there's really good things from industrialization, but there's bad things as well. And so the progressives wanted to fix the bad things, want to maximize the good things and fix the bad things. So you can see some of the things that's happening by this time period. Unregulated businesses. There's really no rules about businesses. We have monopolies. We have all this stuff. Poor working conditions. No rules around, you know, minimum wage or overtime pay for workers. We have workers that are unionizing. They're revolting. Things are violent. Farmers are upset with the populace. Urban growth. Cities are growing too fast. There's no building codes. Buildings are built quickly and sometimes without running water and toilets and all that stuff. And so they want to fix a lot of this stuff, improve society. And so the progressive era is different than the populace because it's different people. Populists were farmers. The progressives were mainly middle-class white people or WASPs, a white Anglo-Saxon Protestants. Middle class, a lot of women were involved in the progressive era. So it wasn't an organized group. And some of the causes that they fought for were actually contradictory. You know, some wanted to increase immigration, wanted to help immigrants. Some wanted to limit immigrants. So there's going to be various things that they will tackle. And so you see some of those eliminating government corruption, really kind of beginning at the city level or at the municipal level. That's what a city, it's a municipality. Women will get the right to vote finally in 1920 with the 19th Amendment. We're going to see a lot of antitrust legislation, things like the Sherman Act and the Clayton Antitrust Act. And so the progressives will really get a lot of the populace, their demands. The progressives will get a lot of these things done. It's also important there were four amendments passed during this era, and those are things that you should know. Going back to Reconstruction, you should know the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, the Reconstruction Era amendments, and you should know the Progressive Era amendments, 16th, 17th, 18th, and 19th. Real quick, 16th Amendment, we get the income tax. 17th Amendment, direct election of senators, so people now vote for senators, not state legislatures. 18th Amendment, we get rid of alcohol, and then the 19th Amendment, women get the right to vote. Now there's going to be some failures or some limitations of the progressives. Generally didn't do all that much for people of color. Most of the benefits were limited to white Americans. Jim Crow laws are still around, the Plessy versus Ferguson cases in this time period. So Jim Crow laws, the separation of the races, that's all happening still. Other things you should know, I just listed some of the things. You could look these up. Initiative, referendum, recall were all ways to get Americans more involved in democracy. And that's one of the things as well, is get people more involved in the democratic process. And all right, moving on quickly here. We're going to talk about World War One. So we talked about Spanish-American War, and let's talk about World War One. Why did... So World War One breaks out in Europe in 1914. We looked at, the assassination of Franz Ferdinand. There's militarism, there's alliances, there's imperialism, there's nationalism, all these things that lead to war. But we're going to stay out. So in 1914, when war breaks out, Woodrow Wilson, the president at that time, says we're going to trade with both sides. We're going to trade with Britain. We're going to trade with Germany. And we're going to make money off of this. And we were. And this really lifted us out of a recession that we were in. The thing is, both sides, the British and the Germans, would violate our neutrality as we were sailing across the Atlantic. We were being harassed by both sides, especially by the British, because they blockaded Germany. As we were trying to trade with Germany, they would, harass us. The German response to that British blockade is unrestricted submarine warfare. And so they would use their submarines, or they called them the undersea boots, undersea boats. And they would shoot down ships, and they shot down like the Lusitania, which was a British ship, but it killed over 100 Americans. That was in 1915. But really, the main reason why we join, suppose that what Woodrow Wilson says the main reason we joined was because of the resumption of unrestricted submarine warfare by the Germans. Other people, you know, historian Howard Zinn would say we joined because of money, to make money. So we joined in 1917. We're in the war for a little over a year. But some of the things you should know is kind of the war at home, what's happening. You know, and this is, you know, 1917, we also have the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia. They're going to become communists. That will lead to the Red Scare in the 1920s. So that's happening as well. So we get restrictions on speech. We get the Espionage and the Sedition Acts. We looked at this court case, the Schenck versus United States, and various things. You couldn't criticize the government, and people were arrested, you know, for Eugene V. Debs got 10 years in jail for giving an anti-war speech. So there was restrictions on speech, which the Supreme Court upheld. But also during the war, I think the war really was one of the main reasons that people got behind the 19th Amendment, which is women's right to vote. Women played a big role in the war. And it was very hypocritical to say that we're fighting for democracy abroad, because Germany was not a democracy. You know, we're fighting for democracy, yet women don't have the right to vote at home. So it's very hypocritical. And so Wilson finally gets behind the 19th Amendment, and it passed in 1920. So after the war, or even during the war, we have the Great Migration as well. A lot of African Americans moving out of the South to places like Detroit, New York City, where there's jobs. So in the 1920s, again, we'll move quickly through. We're going to have this Red Scare, this fear of immigrants from Southern and Eastern Europe that we believed were communists or anarchists. So they'll come here and they're, you know, trying to overthrow democracy. And you, if you want to look at more about this, you could look at the Palmer Raids, the Sacco and Vanzetti court case. We're going to have a major immigration law in 1924. We had kind of an emergency one in 1921, and it's made permanent in 1924, but it's known as the National Origins Act. And what this does is it limits immigration to 2% of the 1890 census. So however many people, like however many Italians were here in 1890, we will allow 2% of that number to come here. So if there's 100,000 Italians in 1890, we would allow 2,000 to come here per year. This picture shows 3%, because that was the emergency law in 1921, was 3%, and it was lowered to 2% in 1924. So some of the topics, 1920s, I'm not going to talk about all these because we don't have enough time. These are things that you should know. You know, prohibition of alcohol, women's suffrage, the Scopes monkey trial, which religion is on trial. Can you teach, you know, Darwin's theory of evolution, or do you teach the biblical version? The Sacco and Vanzetti court case, which shows the nativism, the kind of anti-immigrant sentiment in America. The Harlem Renaissance, Marcus Garvey and the Back to Africa movement. Marcus Garvey is going to be a huge influence on people like Malcolm X. Malcolm X's dad was part of the UNIA, which was a group that Garvey led. We'll see the rise of the KKK, kind of the second wave. The first wave will be after the Civil War. A lot of consumerism, people buying things on credit. That will lead to problems when the stock market crashes, the Red Scare, we talked about, and you can see the other things. So 1929, stock market crashes, we have a Great Depression. So now the Great Depression wasn't just caused by the stock market crash. There were kind of underlying causes, and the majority of Americans didn't actually own stock. But you kind of see there's a lot of things happening today You know, we're obviously there's unemployment issues with our pandemic and all this stuff, but the government response is very different than it was back then. There was hardly any government response to the stock market crash and the economic situation that was happening. Today, we've seen a few $1 trillion of money that the government has kind of introduced into the economy and into the stock market to kind of prop up all this stuff. So, which probably has stopped us from getting into a much worse depression. So some of the causes of this Great Depression: overproduction, farm. There's always issues with farmers. Overproductions, basically, the amount of food that they were producing during the war, they're continuing at that pace. Farmers aren't making money. The depression for them really starts early. People buying on margin, meaning you basically take out a loan to buy stocks. There's a weak banking system in general. So all this stuff, and then the stock market crash in 1929. So the president at that time, Herbert Hoover, Republican, really doesn't do much. He doesn't believe that that's the job of government, is to really, you know, that the federal government doesn't take on this role of this kind of safety net, that would be up to states and to charities to do that. Now, in 1933, we will get Franklin Roosevelt in office, and he will change things. Franklin Roosevelt is really takes up some of these ideas of John Maynard Keynes, who was actually he was British. British economist, but essentially we talked about the circular flow of spending. That my spending, you know, if I go to the grocery store, I help, you know, the workers there. Then they go and they buy cars, and you know, then that person can buy a house, and all. It's a circular flow, and when that stops, that's the problem, and that's really the problem today that we're having. People aren't spending money, people aren't buying gas, and so the state's not getting the gas tax, and the gas tax we use to build roads and all this stuff. So, you know. When people stop spending, there's going to be issues. It's, you know, people will lose their jobs. John Maynard Keynes believes that government should then step in and do what the people aren't, and that is spend. It's called priming the pump. And that's what Franklin Roosevelt's going to do. Now, the question is, does it work? And that's kind of debatable. It probably helped. But ultimately, World War II, I think, will get us out of the Great Depression. But I think what Franklin Roosevelt does help. And so what Roosevelt does is something called the New Deal. He's going to have a whole bunch of programs meant to get us out of the Great Depression. So he's going to reform society. You know, that's reforming the banking system. He's going to give, you know, people jobs. Things like the CCC and the WPA, and really creates this kind of what's known as a welfare state. And this idea begins with Teddy Roosevelt, and you see government intervention, like with the Meat Inspection Act, but it really increases much more with Franklin Roosevelt in the 1930s. So this is a huge change, the creation of this welfare state, of this, you know, government really playing a bigger role in the economy and in people's lives. Before this, you would never even deal with the federal government. Maybe you saw someone from the post office. That was about it. Now you deal with the federal government all the time, and you may not even realize it. So his first 100 days in office, he closes banks for 4 days, reopens only the good ones. We have things like the CCC, the AAA to help farmers. We're gonna have a second New Deal here. The Wagner Act, which actually legitimizes labor unions, so government's actually going to side with workers over businesses. We'll get Social Security Act, which we have today. We have a minimum wage. We have overtime. We have getting rid of child labor. So the New Deal is huge and could definitely pop up as a DBQ. I think it's a little too easy, though. I doubt that they will choose a New Deal. But who knows? Again, I'm always wrong, so. There are some limitations with the New Deal, though. A lot of the programs discriminated against black people. Whether that's on purpose or not is, you know, a lot of people, historians, debate that. Things like the AAA that helped farmers did not help sharecroppers. Helped landowners, and sharecroppers weren't landowners. And, you know, a lot of black people were sharecroppers. So the FHA housing is going to discriminate against black people a lot of times on purpose, for sure, with the FHA. And a lot of that stuff won't be fixed until, you know, later on, 1960s. And so this is a change right here, a change from laissez-faire, where the government stays out of your life, to this welfare state, where the government takes on this role of protecting the health and well-being of its citizens. And we still see this today. And both, I would argue, both Democrats and Republicans do this. We see, you know, we have a Republican president right now, and a huge influx of spending. You know, everyone got $1,200 and $500 per kid, all this stuff. So that's government. That's a Keynesian thing to do. So anyways, that's the Roosevelt and the New Deal. Then in 1939, we're gonna get war in Europe. Because Hitler invades Poland in September 1939 and all that stuff. Anyways, you should know from 1939 to 1941, what was America doing in those intervening? Now, we learned a lesson. You know, we got involved in World War One. We were trading with both sides. This time, we're going to stay isolated. We're not going to trade. So in the 1920s and 1930s, if you might see this question, foreign policy, we're going to stay isolated. We're not going to get involved. We learned our lesson from World War One. So as things are beginning to happen, and first they're happening actually in Asia with Japan and China fighting, we're going to stay neutral. And we're not going to get involved. Eventually, we realize that, whoa, this Hitler guy is kind of crazy. Maybe we need to get involved. And Franklin Roosevelt wants to get involved. Congress doesn't really. And so, but we take steps to get involved in 1939. So after war has started in Europe, we have the cash and carry policy. Where we will trade weapons, arms, to belligerent nations. A belligerent nation is a nation at war, but they had to pay cash and carry it on their own ships. Now, this would apply to every belligerent nation, but really only applied to Britain because they had the means to do this, and Germany really didn't. You know, we talk about the German military and Blitzkrieg and all their tanks, but a very high percentage of the German military was still, they were using horses. To fight this war, you don't really see that all that often because in videos and stuff, but they were running out of gas, and so they had to use a lot of horses and stuff. And so we have cash carry, we have the Lend-Lease Act, where the British were like, yeah, we actually don't have cash and we can't carry it because we're fighting this war. All right, we will lend you weapons, we'll give them to you, and we will deliver them to you. So essentially, after the Lend-Lease Act, we are involved in the war, we just don't have troops there. So the British are fighting the war with American weapons, with a lot of American weapons. So December 7th, 1941, we have the attack on Pearl Harbor. We are in the war. We declare war on Japan, Germany. So most of the stuff, if you see World War II, it will be probably about the war at home, what's happening on the home front. So we have the Double V campaign. So this is African Americans fighting for freedom at home against racism and fighting, you know, fascism abroad. And I think World War II will be a big catalyst for the civil rights movement, which the civil rights movement of the 50s and 60s will not be in the DBQ. But it's going to be, you know, that you see A. Philip Randolph actually in this picture here. We're going to see the Zoot Suit Riots issues in the LA area around Mexican teenagers and riots there and violence. And then women and Rosie the Riveter here, some women will join the workforce. There's going to be a rationing of goods. You guys have never experienced rationing, right? Limiting the amount of goods you could buy. Of course you have. Now you have, right? You go to the grocery store. If there is toilet paper, you can only buy one, you know, pack of it. I've even seen a rationing of beef. So there was a lot of that during World War II. So there's some similarities to World War II and even the Great Depression with what's going on today. So you're living a very historical time. So that wraps up our lecture here. Not bad, 30 minutes. I could probably talk another couple hours about this, but again, research some of these things more. Very important stuff in period 7. As always, let me know if you have any questions.